Or at least definitely the thumbs up from the control board. So.
Take our two.
Yeah. I like that, actually. We started with tonight's caucus. There's one open seat, two open seats that are not functions of the caucus. And as important as that is, the mechanism is the same. If anybody wants to run for elected office, contact the town clerk's office, take out your nomination papers, get those signatures. Always give a few extra. 20 signatures are required. 25 makes sense, only in that a little bit of excess is helpful. That said, they have to be into the town clerk's office 17th, I think, before the election, and then you can be on the ballot. For those who came to caucus tonight, thank you very much. Appreciate that a great deal. Tonight we're going to have the budget presentation from South County EMS. We have some minutes, so a couple of updates, committee appointments, and then we'll be back here on March 14th. So our first appointment is at 7:15. We have a couple of administrative pieces we can take care of. First, of course, would be the minutes of the 29th.
Motion.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded to approve the minutes. These minutes also included interaction with Eversource, and subsequently Eversource has looked at FCAT's broadcast here on YouTube and has reached out to the office to see if there's a way that we can have a conversation with the DG group when they're back. So maybe Tom, you know, shaking the tree was a good idea. That said, the rest of the meeting was pretty straightforward. So we have a motion made and seconded for the minutes. All those in favor?
Aye.
3-0, please. That's the minutes of February 29th. Next, we have two kinds of policy pieces. One here, actually, I appreciate Sherry going back. The charge for the police search committee, we reviewed and we're going to adopt, and a week has subsequently passed, and a good timing to review it and make a couple of simple changes. So this charge is specific to that group. I think it was the addition of some budget data, it was the addition of some salaries, and then, of course, the procedures. Discussion with respect to the search committee?
The only thing, Scott, in the first paragraph is the committee shall provide to the selectmen a list of 3 to 5 unranked finalists.
Mm-hmm.
Do we have limits to 3 to 5? What if they get 7 tremendous?
Yeah, that's a good point. I mean, it shouldn't have a cap. I mean, anybody who's qualified should come forward.
I mean, we'd like 3 to 5. Mm-hmm. I mean, if they're qualified, I don't know, it's up to you. I don't know.
Would it make sense, Tom, instead of having a cap 3 to 5, that having it so the line read no less than 3? Or even that's too narrowing.
Yeah.
Right? You could have. We'll suggest some language. What do you think?
I wouldn't leave it like that. I would say that we should.
Let's see what we get in.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we have that size to bump it up. There's 18 currently. Okay.
Bruce, what do you think?
There's 3.
But you sat on these committees before. I mean, is it better to limit or?
I would have put a lower cap or an upper cap. Because you might only have 2 candidates that are
right.
That are there, you know. I mean,
just a list of candidates?
Yeah. That might be the best thing, a list of candidates.
Right, yeah. How about that, Scott? I could agree with that.
Yep.
A list of a list of unranked finalists from the selectman shop of qualified unranked finalists. How's that?
It's perfect. Again, limiting the lower or putting a cap on it sends a message. I mean, we don't want to do that. We just want to hire the most qualified.
If you have 6 people, fine. If you have 7 people, fine.
Right.
I mean, if you have 2, right. That's fine also.
Yeah. We'll leave it up to the committee to look at what they've got.
So I'd like to amend that, Scott, to read the committee shall provide to a selectman a list of qualified unranked finalists from which a selectman shall interview and may hire for the chief position.
Yep. So out 3 to 5 and just insert the word qualified.
Yeah.
Makes perfect sense. candidates. With that substitution, is there a motion to accept the charge of the police chief search committee as it's amended?
Motion to accept as amended.
I appreciate the fact of having budget and size and, you know, all of that right in the charge. Everybody gets to know what all the numbers are, what the charges are.
Scott, I have been asked by a person that's appointed to the committee about the salary, and I see that we address the salary on the next page. Mm-hmm. That's good.
Yeah, both the salary as well as the operating budget.
Yeah.
As well as the staffing levels.
I would think someone looking at the position would probably already look at those items.
We hope. No, it's not just a matter of...
Is the salary a range?
Yeah, in here we
have... That was the appropriation, current appropriation.
Well, it says, and the salary for the position was 63.5, but we may want to give a range on that, Scott.
We want to give a range on... Well, this piece here is putting history out.
Yeah, it's just right.
It's just last year's appropriation.
Okay.
It's not necessarily what we're looking for in the applicants.
I'm just looking back to last time. That was a big issue.
Yep. So are you gonna put down a range? Okay. Because I mean, you know, last time we had a person thinking.
Yeah.
What's that?
That would be where the board picks up. You
know, I kind of like the range just because in past negotiation, I mean, you can say negotiable, but if a person comes in with $100,000 request, and we can't do that request, we have had something similar to that in the past.
But as I look at this document, Tom, this is for the committee, right?
Yeah.
And it just has the current year's budget value.
That's true. It's not.
I understand, but okay. I think the committee should be in a position, mm-hmm. if asked.
That's crazy.
And again, if you have someone that's coming to interview for the job,
yeah.
You're saying the present is salary is 63.5, mm-hmm. right? That's what it's a budget at. Well, maybe the guy thinks he can get 75 out of this. But Scott, we should be fair to the person saying that we're not looking to hire from you for 75.
Right. In other words, you want to put a cap at least in there so that they can set their
expectations. I think you should have a range. You should say 62.5 to 67.5, or whatever the range that you want to put in there, 62 or 60,000 to 65,000.
I understand. The screening committee also isn't going to be talking about salary. What is Selectman's going to be talking about? Salary?
I think the screening committee should have, if they're asked, they should have the ability. Mm-hmm. We should. How's it advertised? Is there salary? Is there a salary in the ad?
No.
How are you going to? You may if you come in, the person comes in and thinks that he's going to get $75,000. Do we really want to interview that person?
Well, I would go back to your earlier statement, Tom. If someone's coming in to look at the job, they probably have done that homework and see that this appropriation is $63,500. Not unlike what we did with the town clerk, town administrator we just hired.
No, I think we put out there what the salary was.
We did, just like this.
And then
we negotiated over a 3-year period.
Yeah.
I hear what you're saying.
I think you're going to get yourself in trouble if you have someone come in. In the past, and again, going on past, mm-hmm. if you could have a candidate that applies for the job, and then you get into negotiations, and in your negotiations you can't agree to a salary.
Mm-hmm.
I think you could find yourself in trouble for doing stuff that way.
Then I would suggest that we remove the existing salary from the sentence and simply have the operating budget for the department.
That's fine. I still think the chief should understand whoever the candidate is should have an understanding of what the job salary is going to be.
Okay, so what would your suggestion be?
I don't care, 60 to 65, 62 to 67.
The anticipated salary range for this position is...
Right, and you can do whatever you, sure. We can put whatever you want, but you should have and again, the salary is not going to be negotiated by the screening committee, but at the same time, the committee can say, you know, the salary range is 62 to 67, or 60 to 65.
I thought my candidate may ask that as well. It's not unusual for a candidate to ask, or employers to ask what a candidate's expectations are in salary range. So,
I would still leave what the appropriation is. I would just give a range for right now.
Sure. Yeah, there's a second line if you'd like. Right? Again, you have an appropriation for the department as well as the existing appropriation for the current year.
That's public record. It's not like it's a negotiating strategy. Anybody wants to take the spreadsheet out can see it.
I understand.
So if you'd like to have a second line that says here salary expected range.
Yeah.
Right?
You're just trying to set expectations.
And salary is negotiable.
Sure. So again, salary expected range, 62 to 67?
63?
65? 62 to 65. Okay, easy. Second line.
Correct.
Any other suggestions? Okay, with those modifications, is there a second to adopt?
Motion, second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
3-0, please, with the changes.
Okay, next up, we have one more. 2 minutes over. Come on up, SCEMS, let's talk about budgets. Zach, I appreciate you guys coming in tonight.
Of course.
Thank you. Does it look younger now that he's retired? Bruce knows the feeling, right?
I feel younger already.
So we're going to talk about SCEMS budgets, right? And of course, this is an apportionment of a total operating budget.
Correct.
Via the multi-town agreement.
Correct. Yeah. Thank you for having us. I'll speak on Chief Ahern's behalf there. I'm sure you've already... have you already received copies of the budget that's passed out? I've got some extra copies here. Basically, the take-home is bottom line number isn't changing. Level funded from last year. We do have some changes in the budget actually up, and those expenses are increased in rent cost to the department. South Gifford Fire Department is doubling our rent this upcoming year, and also making sure that the administrative costs that the town of Deerfield is entitled to is in the budget. So those two items by themselves account for about $70,000 increase in the budget, which we are funding with an offset of the retained earnings from the previous year. So we have
So how does this get funded forward?
So moving forward, that's a great question. Moving forward, that we're still in that phase where the Bruce Baxter, the consultant who came in, said we anticipate your department's going to cost this much this year.
Yep.
And over the past 18 months, especially that first year, we spent less than that. So we're still trying to figure out where that gap is.
That makes sense.
We imagine we're not going to be spending as much, but we still have more money to spend when we find a permanent home and things like that. So looking forward to future budgets, we anticipate being able to balance all those things out and kind of find where we stabilize.
Mm-hmm.
At least for the time being, because we're an enterprise fund, because we have the benefit of that, that money that we didn't spend that previous year, we can actually go to help equalize things moving forward. I'm still trying to figure stuff out.
The reason I ask is future forward,
we go 3 years, everything's stable, and you go, okay, now we're making the corrections for all the stuff we did.
Yeah.
The prior 3 years, and it's down dramatically.
Sure.
Up dramatically. You want to soften all of those gyrations out of the appropriation process.
Yes, and part of that too is with the retained earnings, we're looking to create, put some of that money into a stabilization fund, for lack of a better term, just so right we can absorb those fluctuations from year to year as we're still trying to figure out what's going on.
Thank you.
It's level funded because of that. The big takeaways too are some of the changes that we've seen is using our money a little bit more smartly. We've been talking about this A2 staffing coverage and how it's just not working the way that we had hoped it would, but we kind of anticipated happening from the beginning. So we're using that money in a different way. So it's already money that we were budgeting for. We're going to use it and try to staff and be a little bit more smart with the way that we're spending that money, and to actually add staff. So we're adding a full-time position, and we're going to add an impact shift, which is just an extra person during the busiest times of the day.
Can you explain that, Zach?
Yeah, so on average, I mean, emergencies come in at random. But on average, between 9 a.m. and 9 p.m., and more specifically 10 a.m. and 6 p.m., we see an increase in calls. And that's just because that's when people are awake. Mm-hmm. So instead of trying to find these local EMTs and volunteers to cover this ambulance around, the second ambulance around the clock, take the money that we were hoping to spend on that and actually put a per diem person, somebody in the station on between 10 to 6. And what that means is we have a regular full-time staff for the first ambulance, mm-hmm. and then we have an extra person now in the mix scheduled, plus me during the day, and there's our second crew for our second ambulance. Mm-hmm. The other thing that allows is it keeps our part-time staff engaged. So a lot of feedback we're getting is now that we have a full-time ambulance and it's going out, all the local EMTs that are remaining aren't getting a chance to go out as often.
Yeah.
So by creating this position now during the day, they can actually work on the ambulance. They'd actually be assigned to the primary ambulance, so they stay engaged, they stay sharp, and then the full-time person is actually released to do community outreach, do other things that other responsibilities in the department that they've been tasked to, without having to dip into overtime or their free time.
So instead of simply scheduling clock hours, you looked at volumes and times.
Correct.
And you're allocating that additional labor really where statistically it's shown.
Right. Right. So because that person is actually on shift in uniform at the station, they cost more than that $8 an hour on call.
Right. Yep.
But it's more smartly spent because that's when we need the coverage. When we look at the times where we've had to go to a second and third ambulance for calls, it's statistically during the day.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, at the night, there's so few calls that it doesn't make sense to try to pay for somebody to be on call during that time.
That's smart.
Yeah.
For you guys.
Yeah. Yeah, pretty great.
So, well, I mean, it's part of the adaptive nature of starting up. This is going to be the second full year.
Yeah, I mean, we're at the 18-month mark now, I mean, give or take, right? Yeah, so we're
so
just...
not quite, we got to groove yet.
Yeah, right. Yeah, yeah.
So, you want to just do me a favor and go right through the, not individual lines, but maybe by category?
Sure,
that'd be helpful?
I realize that on this chart, it doesn't break down the full-time staff and the call staff, but you can actually see that salaries and wages is down $646,000 compared to $679,000. That's using that money more smartly.
Right.
Employee benefits have gone up, and that's the big chunk there is the workman's comp assessment. That's insurance, and that's the town of Deerfield, and that's just the figure that they came back with and said, this is what it's going to cost. And we just grossly underestimated that for whatever reason on our initial budget. So there's some movement both ways there. And then when we get to our expenses line, there's a few things kind of here and there. Cost of medications are a little bit more than we had anticipated. Cost of education and training is a little bit more than we originally budgeted for. That was just a shortfall on our part. We didn't budget enough for what we needed. But the majority, the chunk of that is the $74,000 difference that represents the increase in rent in South Deerfield and the Deerfield administrative costs.
Okay.
Other than that, you know, there's a little there's a little bit here, a little bit there, a little bit less in oxygen, a little bit more in medications, like I said. So just trying to find our sea legs, seeing exactly what our department looks like versus what the consultant thought they did. Let's see, I don't know if there's anything really remarkable or stand out other than that stuff. Training's up, saving a lot of money on software fees. Initially,
can you touch on revenues from ambulance billing?
Sure, yeah, so revenues from ambulance billing is great is the short answer. Initially, when the service was started, we figured about $380,000 in revenue. Now with a full year under our belt, and it actually takes 6 months to see our actual return the way medical billing works. So we have a full year of returns and a pretty solid conservative estimate now is we're thinking it's going to be closer to $410,000. That's great. A lot of that represents just the demographics in the area. A lot of people, well, now in Massachusetts, everybody's required to carry insurance, but we typically don't have an issue with non-payment and stuff. So we have that benefit in the area. So that $410,000 helps a lot absorb these other expenses, obviously. The use of the retained earnings to cover the difference in what would otherwise be a level-funded budget, and then your assessment not changing for this year.
So, and maybe this is more a question for the BU members as well as the director. As municipal entities, we have oftentimes payments in arrears. That is 14 months, 18 months, something along that line. There's a handful of programs where we appropriate and then the money comes in and it flows a certain way, usually to free cash or if there's a specific allocation. Debt reimbursement bonds. Is there thought that's been given to how your revenues recovered will over a viewing time, 2 years, 3 years, be capped and begin impacting the actual assessment of the municipal towns? Right? You can envision this. Listen, my operating overhead hasn't gone up too much. Thankfully, our insurance revenue has gone up, is continued to trend in the right direction.
Yep.
And our appropriation is trending in the right direction. 5 years from now, you get $1 million. Mm-hmm. How do you justify that with is there thinking that's going into that now versus, because that can be used as a talking point for someone who might not appreciate the service completely. So yeah. revenue management is as important as the expense management, I guess, is what I'm trying to say.
Yes. Yes, our breakdown, we use an outside billing agency to do this. So part of that service they provide is just comprehensive reports on percentages of private payer, this type of Medicare and stuff like that. So when we figure out this estimated revenue, that's based on a percentage that we typically get. So we average all the calls we do and we know our demographics and the percentage that we expect to get that, and on average and on average and on average and on average. Yep. And so we can say for anticipated call volume, this is the number we expect to see every year. And now that we're ramped up and we've got that 6 months buffer covered, that is a consistent number that we will see. So by it being factored into the budget, being removed from the budget before we give the assessment of the towns,
it's dynamic enough, I think is what I'm hearing you say. Meaning that the number's accurate enough that you can incorporate it into here and it's built into the assessment.
Yes, no. Yes. So it's not that we're assessing the towns separate from minding what we expect to get from revenue, it's that we're relying on that billing revenue and our estimations on it in order to make our budget. That without that billing revenue, we actually would fall short.
Completely agree. And I understand.
Did I answer? I was having a little trouble understanding what you're saying.
Tracking revenue equal to, at some point, if it's greater than your operating costs, is there going to be a strategy to reduce the assessment to the towns?
Yes, naturally, of course.
As opposed to, those are the revenues, and suddenly you have a pile of money that people can hoot and holler over.
Right. Yeah, well, I think, I mean, I'm not going to speak for the boo, but the plan was always to assess the towns, whatever is left, you know, from our, from not from billing, not from retaining, whatever's left, that's the assessment that goes out.
And that's, yeah, and that's, I guess, is a strategy that's going to be important during the budgets, during the budget discussions in all the towns, and say, and by the way, we're only assessing the difference of what we take in. That's a great way of pitching that message, as opposed to saying, well, what about all that revenue? Anyway, I digress.
It all goes back in.
Oh, I know, it's all going to go back in, I agree with that, Bob. And you know, when we've been, you know, having worked on the budgets here, we could only use the three prior quarters, we couldn't use anticipated when we actually, so our town meeting, we stopped March 31st or April 1st, done. It was revenues to that date. And then it was the rolling of that last quarter into the next year. It's important, but DOR does not allow it. You can't anticipate that revenue.
Yes, yeah. Well, and one of the nice things about this enterprise fund is that if we have retained earnings, that, you know, again, it's the difference that gets assessed.
Correct.
So it's, yeah,
correct. Yeah. It was actually very eye-opening because there was points where we had the DOR come and say to us, you guys are actually thinking a little too...
using that money too fast.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Using that money a little too fast.
Exactly. You can't use that money yet.
Exactly. Good point. So it's a little bit of staffing, and then, of course, primary costs are going to be labor.
Yeah.
Obviously, expenses are expense side is unique materials to trade. And I see in here this capital plan. That's the capital component.
Yes. So a comprehensive capital plan is still something that we're really working on, like individual serial numbers and their dates. And we've got the equipment to try to figure out. We've got that list, but just trying to figure out what that exact plan is. But we're still in these, again, were originally came from the expert consultant that said, typically a department of your size and your service is going to expect to spend about this on average every month, or every year, excuse me. So that still breaks down to that $110,000 in capital, and of that, there's half of it approximately is for an ambulance replacement, and that's on a normal schedule. So we know an ambulance costs approximately $200,000, give or take.
The life cycle.
Exactly. So with so many ambulances, you know, every 4 years we replace one and the rest get bumped down. The other component there, which is this medical equipment, this is those high price items that, again, this is averaged down, and this is based on the consultant stuff. So a cardiac monitor can cost $45,000-$50,000 on its own.
Sure.
So on average, you know, we only have about $60,000, a little bit less for that. That's not necessarily going to cover if a stretcher and a monitor break.
Right.
But on average, that's what we're going to spend a year. So the fact that we didn't spend any of that last year just means that equipment is brand new. We bought it a year and a half ago. We haven't had that issue yet. So, and this is still also one of those things where we're getting our sea legs on that. You know, we don't know. It might be that the consultant was coming from a standpoint where it's a department with a lot of part-timers and they thrash on the equipment. And because
so
we're a department with local providers who, you know, have a pride with the service, they don't thrash on it, so we don't need this money. Again, so this is based on the averages. We're getting our sea legs here, and so we've just gone forward with the same appropriation as last year. Certainly with fleet, obviously, but with the medical equipment as well. And then talking about, there's a breakdown for where we look to put our retained earnings from FY15. This is a component of that contained earnings was that capital that was intended to roll over anyway. That's that $89,000. Also a component of that is the Deerfield indirect costs that Deerfield has yet to take from us, bill to whatever.
That's their support as the billing agent. I'm sorry, as the fiscal agent.
As the fiscal agent, they're entitled to, and this is outlined in the IMA, cost to offset everything their town clerk does, their town accountant does for us, the HR stuff, all that management.
Yep.
In the first year, we didn't come up with that figure until the end of the season, so now we owe back.
Right, so exactly, so that's the retained earnings from that first year. Yep. It's like, hey, we still owe you this amount of money. It's sitting here for you. So that's why that's there.
That's a good place to use it.
Yeah. So the difference the difference that's left there, we're looking at 300 something thousand dollars, is what was not spent from FY15. And there was a lot of disagreement about exactly how much money that was, but that's what it was, 300 something thousand. So as we talked about, $75,000 to cover the budget gap this year. Also, we wanted to put a little bit into that capital ambulance replacement schedule. That schedule was built from $0, $51,000 every year. We'll place an ambulance every 4 years. Well, we inherited a truck that's 15 years old already. Sure. It's way past due. So we're trying to put some seed money in there to actually purchase a new ambulance next year. And then the remaining...
When you say next year, you mean next...
Fiscal year.
This coming fiscal year?
Or yes, FY17 would be the hope. So we would hope to see just around $200,000 in that capital account for ambulance replacement as of July 1, FY17.
So where are you taking it out of, Sam?
That's from the retained earnings.
Where is it listed, though?
The retained earnings usage worksheet. There it is. We have copies here. It was part of the Excel budget that was sent out, so it's someplace. So that additional seed money, what that leaves is $225,000, which we want to address those concerns about. So we've got, and what the terminology is used, this is still what we need to figure out with it being an enterprise fund and kind of being new territory for everybody, exactly what legal terms, but ostensibly operating reserves, so to help absorb what we talked about, that year-to-year fluctuation. You know, that's what the retained earnings is for, and also this building reserves. As we talk about, we need to find a permanent home for the service, irrespective of where that's going to be, we need to do it. So it's, how are we going to pay for that? Either even just fundamentally the studies and the architecture, or the actual renovation costs and stuff like that. Okay. So we have this money that isn't otherwise budgeted, that isn't otherwise appropriated for building expenses, for building something. This is what, you know, we want to exercise our enterprise fund for, that this is money that we have available that we can build in that buffer over time.
So I guess I just want to ask, how are you going to get that $200,000 out of that capital budget? How is the capital budget being presented?
This is a discussion with the town managers, the town accountant, about exactly how that accounting works, how a warrant article needs to work, whether we need to make a specific appropriation out of that for those purposes. This is unfamiliar territory for me. This is a learning experience for me, so I'm not exactly sure what the process on that is.
So we should just talk to our fiscal agent. They should tell you how to do it. We're paying $57,000 a year.
That's a good point.
Let's be serious. Mm-hmm. We're paying a pretty sizable chunk of money. Right. You should go to them and say, hey, how do we do this?
Yeah, absolutely. One, and Doug Finn, the acting town manager over in Deerfield, is currently working on a number of warrant article language for South County EMS with the other town managers. So that is...
I hope Sunderland's not there, because then we'd have to bill them for our services also. We probably wouldn't want that. And again, we're paying $57,000 a year for a fiscal agent.
Sure.
That's supposed to handle those things. I have to wear two hats. But that's what's confusing. If our chief of police or fire chief or school committee or library or they come ask our town administrator how to do it. It's pretty simple. Mm-hmm. We're their fiscal agents. Same thing. You're working under the auspices of the Deerfield, $57,000 a year. You should just go to the town administration. Hey, how should we get this done? Shouldn't need no more help. That's what happened to us last year. And that's why we had three budgets out there. I hope we're not going to do that again. Okay.
I sent them all a copy of one budget.
That's a good start. All right. And I would like to remind the board that the retained earnings that Zach was talking about, we got a significant amount of grant money last year.
Correct.
To help pay for that stuff.
Yep.
So it, I don't know where people think that money's coming back, but there is a significant amount of money, and that's what grant money is supposed to do. It's supposed to be used as seed money to make things happen. Sometimes I guess we forget that too. Okay, I just have to put in my 2 cents worth.
Anything else to cover with respect to SCEMS? No, I don't think so. Bruce?
A couple questions. Why is the rent increasing double to Deerfield? Are we getting double the space, double the amenities? What's the deal there?
I can't speak for the South Deerfield Fire District. My understanding is that their initial rent figures of $18,000 a year included a hefty discount for us being a new service and goodwill. And now that we're successful in growing, that they are matching some sort of square footage assessment figure that they've come up with. So in order for us, this is agreed. They initially said that there was going to be an increase clause in the lease agreement anyway, that over a few years they would increase the rent as we got on our feet. Mm-hmm. And this is the realization of that.
Are we starting to look elsewhere?
We have been. We got one spot we like, and there's been some noise on the other side of the river, and we're supposed to have a meeting.
They're kind of taking advantage of the situation, from my point of view. I mean, if I were to increase my tenant's rent double because they got a better job, having got a cut.
You might not have a tenant, at least not that one. It's kind of like those Comcast deals. It's $99
for
2 years.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
Then it goes up to like $500.
Yeah, but if you call them and talk to them, they'll lower it back down.
We'll cut you a deal.
Second question. How are your fees set?
So, ambulance billing fees?
Yes. How are the fees set? Is it set per run, per mile, per whatever? And
yes.
The benefits included, the employees' benefits, are they included in that stuff too? Because if employees' benefits are about a little bit less than a third of what your employees' salaries are.
So our ambulance billing is set, as I said, it's a separate company, but we bill based on a average for other agencies, other demographics, other towns our size in Massachusetts. So it's kind of an industry standard for private insurance. And then for Medicare and Medicaid, they negotiate lower rates. So we set a rate based on similar departments, and it's both base fees. So if you just take a ride for an ambulance, there's a base fee. And then for additional interventions and medications and things like that, you get charged a la carte
and
for
the
things.
Board sets those fees?
So, yes. That fee, those monies, because we're an enterprise fund and all the employee benefits and everything is included in our budget, then, right, so the, any billing revenue that we see goes to cover everything, including employee benefits.
So just to follow up on Bruce's point, your operating overhead is a value of X. Right? Just is. And remember, Bruce, it's important for me as well to remember, this isn't a for-profit.
Yeah,
I think I'm hearing you say that you, at some point, you know, do the fees at least keep up with the minimum part of the service you can provide? They don't do it exactly, I understand, but also understanding your operating overhead, your man-hour costs, that with a more mature agency,
mm-hmm.
it's going to be important to know that when the door goes up and the lights come on, mm-hmm. that's $150.
No, it's actually,
well, it is.
Scott, you know, you're right on. I would say I don't care what any other town would charge. We know our budget's $1.2 million. We make 1,000 runs a year. We should be charging $1,200.
That's correct.
I mean, to me, it's a pretty simple math. I don't need anybody else. I don't want to make money. But
again, it's not a profit center, but
I would say
ambulance billing usually goes like you charge the high amount right there,
Right.
Most people pay you three quarters of that, and then the government agencies pay you 30%.
Well, just for instance, a typical paramedic response could run a bill of $2,400 easily. That's just a typical thing. Medicare negotiates, they will pay $360.
Sure.
And so that you know, there's some cost sharing and offset and things like that occur. But I think the main thing is an emergency department will never turn a profit and will never cover its, you know, like, sure. That's
sure.
Private ambulances make it work because they take people home from the hospital. They take them to dialysis five times a week, and they can charge that stuff out. Yeah, and they can schedule that so they know that we're going to have calls at this time of day. We'll hire somebody just to work for that call, sure. Type thing. The fact that our billing revenue can account for a third of our budget is extraordinary. When you look at other communities, especially out east, Fall River, they're getting a fraction. It's covering maybe 2% or 5% of their budget, just because of the demographics that they have. So I think I'm very thankful that we can see that much in billing revenue, but you know, I would never expect that in a purely emergency department to come anywhere close to covering just the expenses alone.
They don't look to have that last forever, because they're trying to change that whole thing.
Right.
They don't want us billing. You know, they're crazy.
Dave, you want to weigh in?
I would say it was a good point made earlier too, though, that because there's required insurance in the state, we don't see that part that just simply doesn't get paid at all, which you might see in, you know, like Rhode Island or
sure.
Some other state.
Sure. You know, we still do see that. We have a lot of visitors, especially in Deerfield, either car accidents or people, you know, at one of the tourist attractions. So we still see a component of that, but you're absolutely right that in Massachusetts we have the benefit of having that. Benefit of having that compulsory medical insurance requirement.
Can I circle back around to operating overhead? As you look at your labor units, staffing, indirect costs, and because you're municipal, quasi-municipal, municipal agency, you're going to have legacy costs as well. They're going to continue on retirements, etc. Right? If you were to take all of this stuff that was retained earnings out and just say, okay, it's Monday morning at 6 a.m., the clock starts. It costs me this much this month to run. All of it. Not outside of capital, outside of all of that. Just kind of the raw numbers. Is the department in a position, or the agency in a position, to actually say, yes, it's $275 an hour?
People
are probably going to ask that question at some point. Without this other bits and pieces, capital planning, other assessments, there's this ledger, and then there's this ledger. The basic ledger is going to be an important thing to be able to simply say, here's how much it costs, and here's how much we're invoicing cities and towns through this assessment process.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's extremely easy math to do, right? Yeah. I mean, it's a division problem.
Sure.
The times that we've done that division problem, and people attempt to compare us to other departments.
Yeah, I'm not really one of them.
Well, I'm just saying the story. The rabbit hole here is that we're an enterprise fund.
Right.
Yeah, and it's, you know, the town of whatever does it for a fraction of the price. It's like, they don't, you know, we have to account for everything. But yes, you could absolutely say, you know, per man hour, per day, or whatever, this is what, or every time the truck goes out on a 911 call, that's how much that call costs to us.
Sure. Question I put out there only in that it's completely defensible when you can go $600 easy every time, 1,000, whatever the number is, whatever it is, because as you scale it all up and begin as it is scaled up and annualized, revenue streams come in, and then there's the assessment portion of it. You know, that narrative, I guess, is maybe the word. That narrative people fall back on and say, well, actually, you're paying 34 cents on every dollar that, you know, it costs.
Yeah.
And here's how it works. Go ahead, Bruce.
Another quick question is, how many runs do you go out on where you don't actually transport anybody?
30%.
30%? Do you charge for those?
No.
You don't?
No. Okay.
Good question, actually. It's one of those inherent pieces where you can go, again, it's not a profit center. It's not designed to be a profit center. That said, one of those exact reasons it's not a profit center, just like that. We had to respond, no one was transported, or they refused, or whatever, and we go back.
And there's
good question.
There's the occasional, you go on a call and X, Y, and Z can't pay for it for one reason or another.
We don't care.
We don't care.
On that part, I agree.
I don't care. I would like to go back to Bruce's for one second, though. It's interesting. Now, I don't know if I'll put my Board of Oversight South County EMS hat on, where South County EMS will make a call. Others may deem it a non-life-threatening and or no need to transport. But when you bring South County ambulance, they come in and you look at the patient. The patient may get called for a, because the patient was down and couldn't get up. Others go there and say, help the patient up before you get there. They put them in the chair, say everything is fine, and they walk away. South County gets there because they're coming back from another call. All of a sudden you find out that the patient has potentially life-threatening issues. That person may not have had ambulance care before. Now with South County, the way it's set up, now you're going to get that. And that actually has happened. So South County will go in, make an assessment of the person, and talk to them about transport. And that has been done, and it has worked out very effectively. I know you can't make, it's a good discussion to have with people. Sometimes we don't know how Medicare or Medicaid works sometimes. I don't know how doctors and hospitals make it, because somebody that has insurance is paying for these other programs, and that's what's happened in the ambulance. And that was one of the most confusing things for us with starting South County with Obamacare and a lot of things that were starting up at the same time. It was hard for us to try to put numbers to revenue. We had no idea. We thought we were lucky for almost $400,000 this past year. We thought that was a tremendous number. So.
And that may be the new norm as the
we hope so.
Year two or three continue down the road. Yeah, good points. Anything else, Bruce? Tom, with respect?
Yeah, I guess my one concern that I have looking down the road is that South County, sometimes in all the bluster, we lose sight of what the original conversation is about. In this case, about a home for South County, I think everybody from the Board of Oversight and the three towns appreciates tremendously the hospitality of the South Deerfield Fire District. I mean, I talked to a member of the Prudential Committee, and he has told me that they're not really set up to handle us. They're making do right now. And if they had their druthers, they would have had a two-story building instead of a single-story building, and they would have had those extra rooms and whatever they need. Unfortunately, they don't. I don't know the process behind how the rents are being charged. I don't think their rent is out of, I don't think their rent is out of line, but then again, I know what Whiteley would charge us if we went to the their new town office building. So I hope we can solve that question in the next few months so that we can put all our ambulances together, we can put all our people together. We were criticized, South County Ambulance was criticized not too long ago because we were said that we didn't have a paramedic on duty. Well, the paramedic on duty was Zach, but Zach can't be at the station and do his work. He's in the town hall, Deerfield Town Hall. So we had a paramedic, he was on duty, he was working. We just can't put everybody together. So it is, right now it's inconvenient. It's distractful for the crews. And we have to work a little bit harder to get everybody where they need to be at all times. And so it takes extra it's not as efficient. So hopefully we can solve that problem in the very near future. Again, Bruce?
Yeah, I'd just like to say the service is, I think, is great. I mean, in my previous life, I could listen to the scanner and response time 20, 30, 40 minutes just to get someone to the fire station, and that was all over the county. Mm-hmm. And when you look at what goes out now, I mean, the response time is just tremendous. And I think the bottom line is you're helping the people out with a better response and whatnot, and you know, you try to weigh it with the cost benefit and stuff. And, you know, I think it's a good service for what we pay for.
Thank you.
I, you know, when I see a rent getting doubled, that bothers me, because to me, there's no reason it shouldn't be the same as last year. I mean, you know, but I understand there's issues going on, the whole thing, but the service is excellent.
Thank you. The response times, like you mentioned, are an extremely tangible, objective thing to look at. Also, the level of care we're providing, extremely tangible, objective. I think there's also a component of just having this full-time staff of medical professionals available to the communities. I had one of my full-time staff members recently. He previously was employed at a private ambulance company, so he's straddled that line, private and public. And he thanked me out of the blue, because the department that has been built at South County, he said he's felt enabled to spend that extra minute with that person who called 911, doesn't want to go to the hospital, but he can, okay, do you have a meal set up, you know, for tonight? Is there somebody we can call? I'll wait for you. I'll wait here with you until your son or loved one can show up. And he was thankful that he's a member of a department that encourages that and allows that. And that's something that, not that our previous departments weren't capable of, but certainly not in a position to do as easily or have that consistency, where now people, that same provider who they dealt with a week ago is back through the door, and they already have that rapport.
That's
so
smart. It's actually really nice, it's the soft touch, if you will.
Yeah.
And it's a really important element.
Yeah, and I think that's something that we can do unique to our service that we wouldn't be able to offer anybody in the three towns. You know, were we to go with a private or keep relying on these outside agencies to intercept and stuff like that. So,
it would be nice in a couple of years we're talking about the budget, not necessarily talking about these other kinds of growth pressures.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, and again, I think earlier this evening the moderator asked me about the budget, and I had explained to him what Zach and the service had done to try, because our biggest thing is trying to have people available. And one of the things that Zach and the service found out was that a predominance of our calls were occurring between 10 a.m. and 6 p.m. And Bob, the moderator, said, "You sure you got that right?" I go, "Yeah." And he says, "10 a.m. to 6 p.m.?" I go, "Yeah." He says, "I would thought it would be just the opposite." And in fact, what we're doing now is that we're running the department not so much by what the consultant, who actually did a very good job, but by what we're actually seeing numbers to support what we're doing. So I think if someone was running a business, if you were projecting numbers for a business and you look at what we have projected and what we hit, you were succeeding. You're succeeding. And that being said, when we haven't been right on everything, but when we have a problem, we've been correcting those problems or been trying to make them better. To add, I would, like Bob, if someone told me we're going to add a person from 10 a.m. to 6 p.m., I would say, really? That makes no sense. But our numbers are supporting it. And if you ask our ex-fire chief, Bobby, who listens to the scanner all the time, and I know I talked to Bobby last Wednesday night, and he says, "Tom, they're making their call." He says, "Those guys are out, they're on the road all the time." And he says, and they're making their calls, so it's working. Now, is it perfect? No. We've been in business for 18 months. But the one thing we can say today is that if 3 years ago, we know for sure that there was a call in Whiteley that somebody with a cardiac problem waited 50 minutes before the ambulance showed up. That was not unusual. I would dare say that wouldn't happen today. Even if South County doesn't have an ambulance available, dispatch is on the horn with another one of our mutual aides to get somebody there. So I would say we're in much better shape today than we were 3 years ago. And just for no other reason, we're not perfect. We're trying to do better. Just the way we train, training, and Zach didn't even talk about training. Now they have a different program for training that is pretty much state of the art, where it's taking care of all the EMTs and all the paramedics. We're bringing we're bringing our EMTs, some of the EMTs that started with the force are now becoming paramedics. So we're getting homegrown paramedics, which is an opportunity it didn't have. So a lot of good things. Not perfect yet. We're getting better.
Pretty good.
Good points. It's getting better. It's getting better.
So if there's anything else to go over the budget, if there's not, there's a public information session on Wednesday, March 30th at 7 p.m. at the Whitney Town Hall for all the three towns, the boards, finance committees, the BOO, and I'm sure some of these policy opportunities will be discussed at that meeting.
Yep, and be available to answer any questions that anybody in the public might have, clarifications, specific stuff, things like that. We'll be there to, yeah. I mean, we're always available to answer, but at least that time it'll be, yeah.
Special time, just
that's
set
right.
Aside for
yeah.
That.
Yeah.
Perfect, well done.
If there's look else? For his debut on FCAT coming up.
Oh yeah, we got a piece being worked on FCAT. It's just a kind of a, what is South County EMS, right. What do we do? And so we've got a number of providers interviewed for that, and we're gonna be doing some kind of like an over-the-shoulder ride-along, like makeshift EMS call, so people kind of see what it's like.
And it's the EMS GoPro.
Just strap them to our chest. Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Nice. Well, thanks so much for the time, as well as the work that you guys do in service of the public. Okay, we're going to move on. Thank you.
Thanks,
Chief. All right, so next up, I'm going to go down one more piece here.
No.
Board updates. SCEMS, Tom, so you can almost be up on
it. We had a meeting the other day. With the South County Senior Center, one of the things that we are looking for is a outreach coordinator. It is a grant. It's a grant filled position. It's 10 to 15 hours a week. So we're looking to fill that position. Anybody knows anybody looking to become an outreach coordinator? I would recommend that they contact the director of the Senior Center. We are looking to hire that position in the very near future.
David, I think hopefully gonna wrap up the union negotiations in the next couple of meetings. We're lucky.
Getting close.
Getting close.
Yep.
This is my experience has been these last 3 to 5 meetings are the ones where it's either, fatigue driven,
yep.
Or it's the height of tension. It's one or the other.
All of the above.
Exactly. But, so we saw some emails going around saying that maybe somebody from EverSource might want to come out and defend their position. Yeah, it's interesting to see how that's going to play out. I give the line engineer who was here, lots of credit for bringing that information back, and then to them for looking at it. Now, see the action comes of it.
Well, that's it, right? Now, we did have a call with Beth and Kirsten, amongst ourselves to kind of reiterate where we were in the process, and we've been still waiting for some kind of feedback from those guys, so hopefully we'll get something.
All right, town administrator updates, here we go. We have 14 pages of them.
Not tonight. So you have the recommendation for the mowing bid award. For GBR landscaping, it is $2 less than last year, and that's $98. So it's been rolled in those 27, and that's great.
So, do you want a motion? And the recommendation of town administrator, like to make a motion that GBR landscaping be granted the municipal lawn and ground service for the municipal and the riverside.
Motion is made and seconded to award the contract. That's a 3-year contract. All those in favor? Three to zero, please. We have one other piece of paperwork here, and it's I give Sherry, again, a lot of credit with respect to this committee handbook for the town of Sunderland. It includes work with the town clerk, I'm sure, because there's a big attachment for the open meeting law. There's a helmet and page piece. Now, we have seen many of these public records and, you know, master laws in our experience. It seems to me the interesting part of this presentation is the first 3 pages. And I asked the board to consider approving this as a draft. If there's any changes you'd like to see over the next meeting or two, we can get those changes in place. I say it because we have a screening committee for a police chief that's about to kick off. It'd be nice to have something to hand to them.
Yeah, and the anniversary committee. And the anniversary committee, which is people who have that involved.
So again, you go from page 5 back to almost 11. It's chapter and verse of things that we have plenty of exposure and experience in. But someone who's voluntary for the first time and being appointed, I didn't know I could do that. Or I don't know, God forbid, I couldn't do that. So as a handout, I think it's pretty well.
I'll make a motion.
And again, over the next couple of weeks, we can drill down on these pages and make sure that things that are not chapter and verse right off the state website or out of our existing bylaws, we can amend. Motion made and seconded to adopt this, and we'll get adopt and date on this and have an amend line down the bottom. All those in favor? Three to zero, please. Okay, now we can appoint a committee that's going to get one of these. So it's a dialogue here. The next up to express is the 300th anniversary committee, and I am just thrilled at the amount of people who have committed to either full committees or subcommittees. I think if we focus on the full committee, maybe its size, I think there's 15 people, 15 names. And as I look at those names, there are some very new faces, and there are some longtime participants in the town. I'm wondering, I put this on the form of a question, is as the master committee, right, the grand committee, is 15 too big, or is that something that's manageable and can be pulled apart to direct subcommittees at? Right, you might have 4 people who are really good at whatever, flags, or then they need worker bees out of the other part. I don't know, I mean, I worked on committees 9 to 11, and they seem a bit onerous, but they tended to be policy committees as opposed to do-it committees. And this is kind of a do-it, kind of a do-it committee.
Too big? To me, I think that when you have, now the X are people that really, that have committed to being on the committee.
committees and subcommittees. Now, when you say, we'll talk specifically about the big committee.
What I would say, I would say a point and then and see what happens, Scott.
Okay.
Right?
Again, I think in the timetable, this may be just about the right size of the group.
Yeah, I would say.
Surely we wouldn't be any larger than that.
No.
But they may take aspects of it, three events or whatever.
Well, please understand, I think everybody knows that Tom Tomaski is going to tell everybody that he doesn't want everybody that does to do everything.
Agreed. Oh, yeah.
And he wants everybody to be working on things that they want interest, you know, that their main interest. So I would just, you know, if you want those, let's see what happens.
A point the group that's on the spreadsheet.
Well, the only thing I would say is that I think people should be in town. Something was wrong. To be on the major committee, I don't know if we can have people appoint people from outside of the committee.
No, there is a good point. Something.
So I would put people that are in town.
Uh-huh.
I see there's one person. So if you want to put me as a selectman rep on that committee, that's fine. And see what happens.
Okay. So you want a selectman's rep for the 300th, Tom?
Yeah.
Include you with this slate? And again, there may be people who, you know, as it gets rolling, simply saying, I can't do it. Right? A little bit of attrition. Okay. Well, I appreciate the dialogue. It's always a little touchy when you're dealing with the size of a working group.
Yeah.
You know, because we have controls. Right. You go through certain consternations, like, all right, so. With that said, there's no more dialogue. Is there a motion to recommend, I guess you want to read the names right out, David, under the comm?
Sure. We've got Cindy Benjamin, America Breuer, Shelley Chalik, Janet Connolly, Gail Drake Thompson, excuse me, Wendy Gould, Julie Jackson.
Winya?
My apologies, Winya Miller. Kathy Peterson, excuse me, Pedersen. Jennifer Uncles, Jess and David Wissens, Brenda Wozniak-Evans, Mike Wozniak-Evans, Jenny Tom and Deb Zimnowski.
And Tom is the selectman.
So just let people know, we have almost 60 names.
Yeah. Right. That doesn't include, yeah, so. Exactly.
That's great stuff.
And Marina's going to participate, and she's going to lead the cheerleaders, the Sunderland cheerleaders.
Hey. So
right, Marina?
Sure. We got that slate. Is there a second?
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Again, I thank everybody, as Tom said earlier, there's 60 names up here. All those in favor of the slate?
Aye.
3-0, please. We have correspondence here from the Conservation Commission chair. And this is also follow-up to the DCR purchase of the gun property, which is actually now with Franklin Land Trust. If you wouldn't mind, Dave?
Yeah. This is dated 1st of March to the Select Board from Kirk Griffin, the chair of the Conservation Committee, regarding the DCR purchase of the former gun property. The Conservation Commission fully supports the request from DCR to reduce the 120-day notice period to 60 days for the purchase of parcel map 1, lot 42 from the Franklin County Land Trust by the DCR. The commission agrees that the inclusion of this parcel into the Mount Toby State Forest is a very important conservation measure in efforts to Lake Mount Toby to the Connecticut River. This parcel is on an important wildlife habitat corridor that the CONCOM is fully supportive of.
So again, that's another component in the DCR request. The DCR was reached out to late last week, and we saw correspondence today essentially saying, thank you, we look forward to the notice in the mail. Okay. Anything else to cover tonight?
I just I have one more.
Sure.
I was wondering if the board would schedule a meeting with the planning board and community pathways committee to follow up on the complete streets project.
Yes, that's right.
David and I have attended the training, which was one of the criteria. The other one is to adopt a policy.
Okay.
And a prioritization plan. So I think it was to get everyone in one room and to maybe talk about a policy.
Mm-hmm.
And to talk about prioritization plan. We have the road safety audit.
Yep.
And we also have the transportation element from the master plan.
Okay.
That we could use to maybe formulate that. And that would put us in line to go straight to construction funding, which is grant funding up to $400,000 for implementation.
Okay. So you're thinking within 4 weeks? Is that too short or is that too long?
I was thinking March 21st.
Float it out there with the planning board.
Okay.
All the key players then. There was another grant round. Was it the Pathways? We didn't have the Path Grant.
The path.
Not awarded yet, but we're
yeah.
We're holding.
Not officially.
We're holding out our hopes. Okay, thanks so much, Chair. Mm-hmm. Do appreciate that. If there's nothing else to cover, is there a motion to adjourn?
Motion.
Second.
I thought you wanted to stay.
Yeah.
Reluctantly starting at the gate. Motion made and seconded to adjourn. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
3.75. Call us on at 8:17.